so that there's 20 minutes for over there. Oh, right, it was a, it's there. 20 minutes for Q&A, because sometimes the most like fun and interesting part of any talk is when we actually get to balance ideas and balance questions back. On the other side of the BioWellness Network, which is basically online newspapers from lots of different regions and now nations, because we have BioWellness Scotland and BioWellness Cumbria, and it's it facilitates, and this overlaps a lot with European movement, citizens getting together, having a voice and writing about stuff and engaging stuff and pushing democracy from the grassroots up, locally, regionally and nationally. And so, for me, it's delightful now that I have two excuses to really care about Wales, one being BioWellness Cymru, the other being Wales for Europe, and seeing lots of groups that that sort of died down when we had that bludgeoning from the 2019 election, and then a couple of years of COVID, and actually now popping back into existence, less than a failure. And even amongst those that voted Leave, 37% said it'd been more of a failure, 35% said it'd been more of a success, and the rest weren't quite sure yet. But you can see the way that it's going. So it is very clear that in terms of what Brexit has delivered or has not delivered so far, people have seen all of the pain, all of the barriers in red tape, all of the extra costs that have been laid in on, all of the disempowerment actually of devolved settlements around it too, and as well as pulling some things that, for example, to preempt discussion of Wales, let's take for example the regional development funding, that used to be something that was there by international guarantee according to international impartial formulae as part of the European club that we were all part of. As soon as you come out of that, the government in Westminster starts saying who will get what into what region, and then they're slow to deliver it, and oops, I'm sorry that so many small charities are going out. So people can see lots and lots of the pain of Brexit and they're not seeing any benefits. Nevertheless, still, if you ask Brexiteers, most of them would vote for Brexit again. A lot of them think it's a point of principle, sovereignty in general. And most of them, about 61%, think that it will turn out good in the end. They can't tell you exactly why, but they've got this feeling that we're just going to do things better than 27 countries putting their heads together and working as a team. So, I think what this all indicates, it's like the different stages of grief, right? You go through the heritage and you put them all through the shredder, and we're going to diverge so far, they were thinking, that we could never get back with the EU. They really wanted to kind of like salt the earth there, make sure all the cords were cut, so that even a future government of the UK would find it far too difficult to rebuild with the EU. Well, that slowly at first and then more dramatically blew up in their faces, and that bill did go through, but just with a small number, huge, because even though they promised originally they would keep it, that was another sign of the bust up. And the government was even trying to sell this new alternative science program, whereby instead of collaborating with all the European countries as leaders, then with the rest of the world through this platform, we go off and sort of make our own platform to do multinational collaboration. It just didn't make sense. We didn't have the money, we didn't have the buy-in from other countries. So that failed, and we actually got back into Horizon Europe, and our scientists were delighted, and now they can work as European teams again. And I'll tell you this, the EU science program, Horizon, is unique in the world. Like all countries in the world participate in it. It's just the EU member states and the associated countries that put money in the budget and can actually lead the big multinational teams and host some of the prestigious grants on their own ground, in their own institutions. But it's expanding because even New Zealand has now joined. So this is it. This is the global engine, and it's expanding. We used to run this thing and lead more projects than any other nation. So it'll take us a while to get back, but we're on the way back. And I'm hoping that following this, we can do a similar thing with Erasmus and make sure, particularly for youth, that all these kind of opportunities of exchanges, whether it's Erasmus or whether it's visa-free travel for, you know, 18 to 35-year-olds, or preferably free movement for all, we can start to break down some of those barriers again and actually have those opportunities again for young scientists, young students, people who just want to work in different countries, those who want to set up businesses and have an easy trade, and all those opportunities start coming back in. But what I wanted to emphasize there is that there is a lot of movement, not just in the polling, but also in the political reality. A lot has happened over the last year, and there is going to be a general election next year. And even though it looks incredibly likely that it will be Labour, even if it weren't Labour, there are some real economic realities that mean that any government coming to office would have to be rebuilding with Europe. That is now the direction of travel. So that all looks good, that all looks really encouraging. And I'd say to the students here that, you know, if there is a time and place in the world to be, this is actually a very exciting one. Because the build back to the joining the EU is not just something that's in our national history, it is also really important in European history. We've just seen the size of the elections in Poland. Ukraine could be joining the EU. And there's certainly a lot of other countries lined up to do so. And if we were to come back into the EU, this would be really important on the continental level. And that, in turn, is massively significant on the global level, because the three big powers at the moment, for markets, for science, for regulations, for ways of doing democracy and organizing themselves, is the US, China, and Europe, all coming back to life that existed before, others that are just starting to pop up on social media. So there's a real sort of community there as well. And EMUK is trying to provide more and more services for that community. So the campaigning isn't just us going and hobnobbing with politicians in London, but rather in each and every place around the country, what can we do to get behind what you're doing so that you're feeling empowered? Come on, let's keep going. And we know that that's going to be better for our happiness, for our opportunities, for our economy, all those different parts. But that is the step-by-step bit. And so what we're doing centrally at EMUK in terms of the team, I came on board as chair end of March, so I've been doing it for just over 6 months now. And one of the first things I had to do is find a new CEO, because our CEO, Anna, was leaving going back to the charity sector. She'd done her stint here. So I got a new CEO in, and we, the executive, we did a big hunt out and got in a new CEO, who is Nick Harvey, Sir Nick Harvey, who was previously CEO of the Liberal Democrats. The arguments for building back are always about people, people's lives, and location, and what it means for your businesses, your youth, your opportunities. And we also found in 2016, well, and I was saying at the time, to people running Brickstrom of Europe, people don't want to be told what to do by, you know, celebs that are living half their lives in Hollywood or politicians at the top. If you're in the fishing industry, you listen to other people in the fishing industry. If you're in the farming industry, you listen to other people in the farming industry. You know, and you listen to people who've got similar lives to you, but they're community champions, and they've done more thinking and working on the traveller to leading doctors and nurses and community leaders, people who are running local important community businesses and things like that. And that means sort of building up everywhere and being inclusive everywhere. Now with Wales, just like in the UK, the polling on rejoin has been opening up. So I just looked at it again this morning. It's also precisely 63% for rejoin versus 37% out. And it's been staying at that for a while. If you want to look at it yourself, go to wethink.report, click on the Brexit graph, and then select Region Wales. And you will too be able to see it week by week. So the polling is a really good place for Wales, because Wales votes Brexit. But it's really turned around, right? And right, you've got more and more people to fill out your local groups as they start up again, like Cardiff for Europe. And we've got about seven different four Europe groups around Wales, don't you?
Yes,
Swansea is a really sort of strong one too. I remember helping Lee a lot with that. And Wales of Europe has grown since the beginning of the year in membership from dozens to hundreds. And part of that is the work of the NUK, meaning shared membership. So as we work hard to advertise and get more people, firstly on our email lists, and then convert those people into members, if they're based in Wales, we say, would you like to be a member of Wales for Europe? Because we can use our power to make sure that we're filling your ranks and filling your coffers. And also, of course, and we've got Joe here, the pressure from the Labour Party and the Lib Dems. Look who's likely to get into power in just about a year's time. And look at the build of European Movement UK. It's up and up and up and up. So I understand. Well, essentially, if you have the opportunities open, then there are plenty of places actually across Europe that are very, very receptive to trans community. It was easier to point the finger at the EU, just meant that you couldn't get something decent together on time. And it certainly didn't have breadth and depth, and the only thing they were going for was economic fear. It's absolutely true, because that's what they were telling me. I was saying, look at all the good things you can say about the EU, and they were like, Mike, that's great, but our job is to get this over the line. We've identified economic fear is the way to do it. So in all of your messaging, can you just include that, you know, this would screw up the economy? Thank you. And that was pretty much how they addressed me. So we're in a different situation now, because we've got a lot longer period of time. We've got more veterans on our scene. We've got more of an ecosystem. We've built up the local groups. We've also tested the fantasy of Brexit and seen it fail. So we can rebuild from those ruins and say, we've got the evidence, we've got a better structure, we've got more experience, and so step by step, we can start rebuilding now. And it's a very different environment. So that's what I think the key difference is. And the other question about how far do we go with integration? For me, I don't know. I mean, it's up to the public. I think the question of the euro is an interesting one. I mean, do they even want us in the euro after Liz Truss did what she did? I mean, do you want to run a central bank that also includes the UK? If they're going to make a uncosted spending promises that put the boot into the economy overnight. So essentially, it may or may not be demanded of the UK. A lot of people talk about the Copenhagen Convention the Copenhagen criteria, which was a set of criteria of what you have to have in place in order to join the EU. But that was just a set of non-binding criteria that was cooked up about 30 years ago in the 1990s when they were looking at a big expansion of the EU eastwards. We're like, right, we've got all these different countries on the books wanting to come in. What are our fundamental criteria that they need? And when that went away, we were at the complete whims of the Conservative Party in Westminster, and when and how much they saw fit to dole out, especially using pork barrel politics. We need to be back into a structure that cares about equal regional development all over Europe, including Wales, because we were high on their agenda, just like Northern Ireland was high on their agenda, because we know that our governments in Westminster play games, but we know that we need something that we can really strongly, stably rely on. Look at Port Talbot and all the support that it got down the decade, the infrastructure around it. And we said at the time, oh, that's our money. You know, we can just claw it back and do that ourselves. You know, we didn't claw it back and do it ourselves. Our government clawed it back and then decided whether or not to do it themselves. So I think that particular line of argumentation would work a lot better in the valleys. It would be a lot more emotive, a lot more about loyalties. Who's really got loyalties here? But that's just my first instincts, because essentially what we need to do is for you guys to go out there and then kick the tires on different sort of vehicles, see what reactions you're getting back, write little summaries of it, and then we can work with you on developing it and saying, oh, we...
I worked in Brussels, I was Director of Policy in the Welsh European Funding Office, I've worked in local government as well as a principal European officer. I taught European integration in Aberystwyth University for 5 years as well. It was my first job after graduating. But I'm keen to hear...